Hey, welcome to Church Experience Online. We're so happy you joined us today. As you're watching this teaching video, if you have any questions or need help getting connected, please feel free to contact us by phone or email. Also, our website is the best place to go to get access to helpful Growth Step resources, join a serving team, connect in a life group, get your questions answered, or support this movement financially by giving online. At the end of this teaching video, you'll hear a Church Experience Worship original song. We hope this gives you time to worship and reflect on what you've just learned. Thanks again for joining Church Experience Online.
Christmas. So great to see you here tonight. Thank you for coming out on a Friday night to celebrate the most important person that's ever lived on this planet, Jesus Christ. That's right. There's never been a name that's ever been spoken by any lips that is more honored or more worthy than the name of Jesus. Jesus is the name above every name, and he is the most amazing person that you could ever sit down and spend time with. But the incredible thing is that Jesus, even though he's so high and lifted up, he's so accessible. And the story of how he was born is such an accessible story. I mean, he was born in a very common way. You would expect a king that is above every other king to be born in such a majestic and extravagant way, something that would break news and just be this incredible release of information that he's here, he made it. But it was announced in such a humble way to some shepherds out in the field, right? Some people that came from afar searching for this Savior born under a star. I mean, it's incredible how he was born, but it was such a accessible Savior, one that wants to be personal and connected to each and every one of us. And I want to read from his story tonight of how he was actually born, and there's so much that we can learn from his story, and I want to share that with you tonight. Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 26, we're going to start with his parents, who were not expecting the Savior of the universe to be born in their household. In fact, I'm sure they had plans. Probably had plans to have a family and a family vacation and how they're going to raise their kids and what they were going to name their kids. But all those plans were completely changed when God showed up. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of a greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus." So Mary is not expecting to have a child because she's a virgin. And so, of course, there's no possible way that she could be pregnant. But then how would you feel if someone came to you in the form of an angel and very authoritatively tells you that you will have a child and you are pregnant? And not only are you carrying a child, you're carrying the Savior of the universe, God's own son. This is the kind of news that we really can't wrap our mind around, what it would have felt like to be in Mary's shoes. But nonetheless, she experienced this moment where the angel said, "You are going to conceive and give birth to a son. Although you are a virgin, this is a miraculous thing, and it needed to happen that way." Why? Because if Jesus were born of a man, then he would be fully man. But he was not just born of man. He was fully man, but at the same time, he was fully God because he was born supernaturally of God in Mary as a virgin. And so he came as God and man, and he came and he walked among us. He was born, and obviously we know his story. He lived and he died for us, rose from the dead, and did all this so that you would know how much the Father in heaven, how much God loves you and would do anything for you, even to the extent of sending his own son to die for you so that our sins could be forgiven. I mean, this is the story of Jesus. But it begins in such a humble way. He's born into this family who was not expecting it. In fact, they were chosen not because they were of, you know, great wealth or fame. They were chosen because of something on the inside. In the same way that in the Bible, God chose King David to lead his people, the nation of Israel. He chose him because he said, I don't look at the things that man looks at. I look at the heart. And God chose Mary because of who she was. The angel said to her, Mary, you found favor with God. You know, the handout we gave you on the way in, you got a clipboard at your feet and a pen. Maybe you want to take some notes. Maybe you'd like to write this down. It's a great lesson for us. Here it is. Godly character attracts the favor of God. Godly character attracts the favor of God. And what I love, what I just love about this story is that Mary was chosen to give birth to Jesus because of who she was. Mary, you found favor with God. You know, I want God to pick me for some amazing opportunities. I want God to use me. I want my life to matter. And I hope you feel the same way. I hope you're on the edge of your seat saying, God, pick me, put me in the game. God, use me. I want my life to count. I want my life to matter. So how does that happen? How does God look down from heaven and all the people that are on planet Earth? And how does he say, hey, I've chosen you, Mary, for this very special assignment? Now, you're not going to get that one. The Savior was already born. Check, that spot's been filled. But God has so many other opportunities where he wants to use people, and he has a great track record of using people to do incredible and supernatural things. Very normal, average people. But people that have supernatural character, people who have character that honor God and have character that's been shaped by God. And Mary was one of those people. She was someone who found favor in God's eyes, and she had godly character. And when you have godly character, listen, you want your life to be different in 2017 than it was in 2016? You want God to show up in a supernatural way in your life like he did in Mary's life? Develop godly, God-honoring character. And that's what Mary did, and that's who she was. She was just someone who honored God and lived for him, and she found favor in God's eyes. And God selected her for this incredible assignment. You know, it's been said that character is who you are when nobody's looking. And I think it's a really helpful definition for character because it brings to light the question of who are you in the dark? Who are you when nobody else is looking? But it also brings up this point that there's not actually a time when nobody is looking. God always is looking. God's always watching. And he knew who Mary was when nobody else was watching. He knew the motives of her heart. He knew why she did what she did, as he does you. And he looked inside Mary and he saw someone who wasn't perfect, but somebody who was genuine and was humble and was honoring God on the inside. Could that be said of you? Because, you know, somebody is always watching. You know, you can't surprise God. We can be surprised, and it's fun to surprise people, right? I mean, some of us are looking forward to maybe Christmas morning or maybe Christmas Eve, whatever your family tradition is, and maybe you can open some presents with some friends or with some family, or maybe there's some other thing that you're excited about. But man, I love to watch when people are surprised, don't you? I mean, isn't that fun? Well, now that we live in the kind of the YouTube generation and people always have a camera on them, we catch those surprises more often. We get to see things that people in previous generations didn't get to see. We get to see other people's surprises. This is really fun. Check it out.
Yeah!
right? You're thinking, whatever he's got, I want that, because that looks pretty awesome. He's excited. You know, it's fun to watch when people are excited about something they genuinely are excited about, because they're surprised. I got this thing. But did you know that you can never surprise God? You can't, like, see, God knows what's going on. You can't be like, okay, God, I've been holding this back. You didn't know this about me, but woo, here it is. He's like, I already knew. You know, it's a little melodramatic. I already kind of knew that. I've been watching you ever since you were shaped in your mother's womb. I've known you, the Bible says in the Psalms, that he's known you intimately. And that's this amazing thing, is because it also tells us that God loves us unconditionally. So he loves you no matter what you do, how many mistakes you make, all the failures you'd love to hide from everybody else, all your flaws that you hope other people don't notice. God sees those things. He knows them. In fact, he knows how many hairs are on your head. He knows your past, your history. He knows everything about you. But he looks at you and he says, I love you regardless of anything that you might try to hide and hold back from others. I know those things and I love you for who you are. You can be secure in that. You can rest in that, that God cares about you and he knows you. But he knows your character. And he knows where you are, and he knows where he wants you to be in 2017. He knows how he wants to take you to the next level in your faith and your character. And when you develop godly character, that's a magnet for God. He looks and he's hungry. It says in the Bible that his eyes range throughout the earth, looking for those whose hearts are fully committed to him. God's looking for a man. He's looking for a woman who will say, God, here's my life. I'm fully yours. I'm all in. And what could God do when he's partnered with the person who is fully surrendered to him? He can change the world. And God is hungry for somebody who will say, God, I'm all yours. And I want my heart to be pleasing to you. I'm fully surrendered to you. Well, God chose Mary, but he also chose someone else. He chose someone else to be a part of this, what we would put together as a, you know, maybe around your home, a nativity set. You have Mary and you have baby Jesus, but you also have Joseph. And although Joseph's not the biological father of Jesus, we know him as the dad who raised Jesus, and he taught him, and perhaps possibly taught him his skill of being a carpenter. It came from his dad, probably showing him how to build stuff and spending time together, raising him, you know, and all that. And that was a special assignment, to raise the Son of God. If you're going to let someone raise your son or your daughter, like if you couldn't do it, you're going to look really hard to make sure that person is someone of character, someone of integrity. And God found the right guy. He found Joseph. And I want to read to you some of his story, found in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law. So he was a God-honoring man. And yet he did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. So they were together in the sense of kind of like what we would call maybe similar to like an engagement, where they had committed their hearts to each other, but they were not fully connected together. They've never slept together and been intimate together. She was still a virgin, but they were together. They were committed. But he finds out that she's pregnant. How do you feel about that? If you're engaged to someone, you've never slept with them. As far as you know, they're a virgin, and then they say that they're pregnant. Well, you're crushed because that means that they've cheated on you. They've betrayed you, and this person is not who you thought they were. And we know that Mary is this God-honoring woman. And so Joseph's thinking, how did she fool me? She seemed like the most incredible woman ever. And then now this, like he had to be heartbroken. But it says that because he was, listen to this, he was such a God-honoring man. He was faithful to the law. He honored God so much. See, this is why God chose him. He had such character. He had in mind to divorce her quietly, to separate from her, to break off this relationship quietly, to honor her. Because why? Because he loved her. He really loved Mary. And that's something special, that he really cared about her. So much so that he was willing to put his reputation at risk. Because for him to do this quietly, he's not doing what's most advantageous to himself. He's disadvantaging himself, because when the word gets out that Mary's pregnant and everybody knows that they were engaged and they were together, I mean, who would you think got her pregnant, right? I mean, you would think, Joseph, all right, come on, man. Like, you're saying you didn't do it, but really? Like, who did? You know, tell us who did. God? That's the story? Right. It's like, you're not buying that. You think it's Joseph. So he's willing to risk his reputation. Why? Because he loves her, because he's a man of character. He's a man of God. See, God chose Joseph because he knew he could entrust him with this very important role. He knew that Joseph was someone who honored God. Verse 22, All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. One of the names that we refer to Jesus as is Emmanuel, God with us, because God came to be among us and with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him. And interestingly, whenever you see God talking to Joseph, it's through an angel in a dream. My wife pointed this out when we were looking at this story. She said, you know, it's interesting. Every time he talked to Joseph, it was through a dream. And he said for him to take Mary home as his wife, but he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. So they got to name this baby, ordained by God, Jesus. They got to give him the name. Wouldn't that be an incredible moment, like to name the Son of God, and we're giving you the name Jesus. And they started calling him that name around the house. I kind of wonder, like, what it was like when he started crying, or if, did he cry like a normal baby, or was he, like, totally perfect all the time? Like, did he have messy diapers? Was it ever like, oh, Jesus, you did this again? Or was it like, I don't know, it's just kind of weird to think about it. Like, I feel kind of wrong. Like, did he ever, like, you know, like, make a mess, and you're like, can you clean up? Like, or did he just boom? And it was like, you know, I don't know. I don't know what we know he can do miracles. So I don't know. When did that start? Like, you know, and we know his first official miracle, but I don't know. Maybe there's some things as a kid that, you know, his toys, he's like, boom, done. It's like, Mom, my room's clean. It's like, that's awesome. I just did that. So Jesus is someone who is born into such humble beginnings, but he's born into the right home, to this mother and this earthly father who would raise him, Joseph and Mary, and they were selected because of their character. And Joseph, you know, this is interesting that he has first assumed that Mary had betrayed him, and that's why he was going to break off the relationship. And it wasn't until God intervened that he decided to stay with her. Now, here's what's interesting to me. This is kind of a side but helpful thing for us to learn. So he was going to leave Mary, a single mom, to raise Jesus herself because he assumed something that was not true. He made a false assumption based on the information he had, and he almost left hurt and offended and brokenhearted because of something that wasn't actually accurate. But it's what seemed like the truth that had happened. Mary, instead of being honored, as we think of her as an honored mother, she almost was someone who became a woman of shame with a man that left her because of a betrayal, and how would that look? And all because of false assumptions. You know, I wonder how many times we falsely assume things about people that are not true. We believe the worst instead of believe the best. In Corinthians, it tells us this great definition of love. It says, love always trusts. You know, we believe the best until proven otherwise. We trust. And then when people let us down, we forgive. And we, you know, it's not that you don't put boundaries around someone if there's harmful situations and all that. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying we trust and believe the best in people. We don't assume the worst. We assume the best. And Joseph, he learned that lesson. Wow, this is not as it seemed. It was God was at work in the situation, and it turned into be this miraculous situation, but it could have been a mess if he had not been interrupted from his plans by God's divine plan. But Joseph, because of who he was, got selected for this amazing assignment. God, please pick me. God, please use me. If that's the cry of your heart, God, I want my life to matter. Well, here's how you do it. You develop godly character, and that's what Joseph had. And in a moment where there's incredible pressure on him to separate himself from this woman, he heard from God and he stood his ground despite whatever reputation cost that may have been in his life, and that would have been a lot in that culture. He decided to stand his ground and do the right thing. And so God could entrust him, and that's why God selected Joseph. In your notes, maybe you want to write this lesson down. Character is displayed inside crisis and under pressure. That's not just where character's formed. It's displayed in those moments. How did you do this last year when you were under pressure, when you were stressed out? Maybe it was this last week and you're trying to get the last minute presents, you know, and you're running around town and everybody's already got the things you're trying to get in your long lines. And how have you been doing under that pressure? Now, I'm sorry. I know that was not a fair question. Bad time. But you know, you know what it's like to feel pressure. And you know what it's like to be in crisis. Maybe you had a crisis in 2016. Maybe you're in the midst of one right now. And if you are, I'm sorry. And it's hopefully encouraging for you to know that you don't stand in that crisis alone. We're here. We'd love to help. If you want to let us know, you can write that on the card. If we can come alongside you in some way, we'd love to do that. But you're not alone, not just because there's others around you that care about you. You're not alone because God is with you. and he's in the midst of that crisis with you. But when you face crisis, when you face pressure, that's when your character is revealed. And Joseph, under crisis, revealed that he was a man who honored God in his choices. He was who he said he would be. You know, under pressure, you can do a lot under pressure. In fact, when you're under a tight time frame, there was a video that was released by WestJet. It was so cool. They had some people that showed up to an airport and gave their wish list to a computer screen, not knowing what was going to happen. I want to share just real briefly with you the adventure of what happened after they revealed their wish list to Santa. Check it out.
"'Twas a night before Christmas, and all across the land, the good folks at WestJet had a miracle planned.
Oh, hello there! Is that Cohen? What would Mommy and Daddy like for Christmas?
Big TV.
Yeah, big TV.
What I need is new socks and underwear.
An Android tablet.
While the guests told their Christmas wishes to good old St. Nick, WestJetters took notes and got ready to shop quick. It was a great rush with the two flights in the air to get all those presents, not a moment to spare. But was everything ready? We all had to wait for the moment of truth at Carousel 8. Never expected what they'd asked of St. Nick would actually appear. It was all quite a trick. A WestJetter would say, it was more than mere fun. Miracles do happen when we all work as one.
That's pretty cool, man. Yeah, that's pretty awesome. Now, I know there's somebody in here that's saying, man, that's pretty cool. I mean, I'm glad they did that, but that wasn't my experience. The last time I flew, they lost my bag. It's like, I don't want a gift. I just want my luggage back. I want that shirt that I had that I, you know, it's like, it's gone. You know, talk about doing something under pressure that really made an impact. It's pressure, you know, and not just for them to pull that off when people are in the air. Just traveling is a lot of pressure, right? When Mary and Joseph had to travel for this census to go to Bethlehem where Jesus was born, that had to be pressure. I mean, just traveling, we're going to get to travel a little bit over Christmas and get to see some family up north. And it's, you know, it's stressful traveling. I mean, being in a car with our four children, I love to drive at night because they're all asleep. It's beautiful. It's like everyone's sleeping. No one's saying, I got to go to the bathroom. I mean, I remember one time spending an hour at one particular rest stop because each of my four children consecutively had to go to the bathroom. And it was like one would go into the bathroom and it took a long time and they came out. And it's like they had planned this because they come out and the other one's like, oh, wait, hey, I think I have to go too. I'm like, really? Okay. And then they went in and then they come out and they're like, all right, you guys ready? And someone else is like, oh, wait, Dad, I guess I actually have to go too. I didn't think I did, but I do. It's like, are you kidding me? So I love driving when everyone's asleep. Because it's a lot of pressure, right? It's a lot. And you know, how do you do when there's, how are you when there's a lot of pressure in your life? When there's stress, when there's a deadline, or when there's someone in your life that's hard to get along with, or when there's a challenge, or when things don't go your way. See, Joseph had the character when things were difficult that he honored God, and God honored him by giving him this amazing opportunity. Luke chapter 1, I want to go back to Mary's story. Luke chapter 1, verse 34. Mary's, of course, curious how this is going to be possible because she knows she's a virgin. I mean, others could have doubted it, but she knew that she had never been with a man in that way. And so she asked the angel, "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin. I know that I am a virgin, and so you're telling me I'm pregnant. How is this possible?" Verse 35, the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her 6th month. For no word from the Lord will ever fail." Now, I love that line because there are things in our life that seem impossible or things that we might be up against as you go into a new year. You're kind of dreading it because maybe there's something that you're not looking forward to. Maybe there's something kind of out there that seems uncertain, or there's a fear in your life or something that's causing anxiety. And you're like, just, I don't know how this is going to work, and it's impossible. Well, Elizabeth, Mary's cousin, was said to not be able to have children. And God said, well, yeah, she's pregnant. And Mary was a virgin, so that's impossible scientifically. And then she was pregnant. And so here what God is teaching us is that with man, there's things, as it says in the Word, with man, there's things that are impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And in our life, we really believe with convictions of steel that there's things that in our lives that might seem impossible, or that there's prayers that we pray that seem unanswered, but God is capable of doing miracles. And maybe you have a health report that you'd like to wave in someone's face and say, there is no way. And God would love just for you to place that in his hand and say, you know, trust me in this, pray in this, and maybe God will do a miracle. And listen, if he doesn't, we're all terminal. This life's not forever, but in that process of placing your life in his hand, he opens up things inside you and gives you peace that transcends all understanding that maybe you wouldn't have had in that moment. You know, and maybe there's something in your life and you're saying, here's the bills and I don't know how it's all going to add up and the math doesn't make sense. And God's saying, I need you to trust me with even this hard area of your life. And let me show you some miraculous ways I can provide for you. I care for the birds of the field, and how much more valuable are you than they? And so I'm going to take care of you. And maybe you'd have some kind of situation in your life that you'd love to kind of push out there and say, listen, this is impossible. Like, there's no way this is going to turn out for good. And God would say, could you just trust me with that? Because I know it seems impossible to you, but it's not impossible with me. And so Mary is pregnant, and so is her cousin, and neither one of these things should be able to be possible, but they were with God. And verse 38, final verse in this part of the story, Mary responds and she says, first she's curious, like, how is this going to be? But notice the difference in how she responds now in verse 38. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. So first she's curious, but then she shifts, and now it's more the word that I would say is conviction. She has conviction. She's like, okay, I believe. May your will be done. And we all start there curious. Maybe that's why you're here tonight. You know, I don't know what I think about faith. I don't know what I think about God or being a church, but you know, it's Christmas, and what the heck? I'll just go, and maybe if someone drug you here, or you came with them, or you did it just to appease somebody, or maybe you came because you're really interested, but you know, we all start there. Now, many of you have moved beyond curiosity, and you're closer to where Mary's at now. But that's the hope, is that we would all shift to where she is at, and it's in your notes, and it's a question for you and for I to consider. Have we moved from curiosity to conviction? Because we begin our faith journey with curiosity. I don't know. I've tried a lot of other things in life, and none of them have ever fulfilled me and brought me deep peace, and none of them have really explained the big questions of life, like, where do we come from? And, you know, it takes more faith for me to believe that this is all just an accident. So where do we come from? And what happens when we die? Because it seems pretty dark to think that this is just, you know, I get these, if things go well and without cancer or car accidents, I can make it 80-something years, then that's all, and then that's it, and it's over and lights out. I mean, it seems pretty, like, dark and hopeless. And so those things are pretty, so who can answer these questions for me and these wrestlings in my life? And you know, I've tried a lot of different ways to bring joy into my life, success, and maybe some kind of pleasure that I've chased, and these things never really fulfilled me. It always left me wanting more. And so in the end, I come to this place of curiosity, and we begin there. We take different journeys, but we kind of begin there. But we have to at some place move from curiosity and just kind of casually following God and church attending, and move to being the church and being convicted about this faith that we have, and living beyond just casually following Jesus to being committed followers of Jesus Christ. And if you will, in this year ahead, place your life fully into God's hands and say, God, I trust you. I'm in, all in, and whatever you want of me, I'm going to be surrendered to you. I'm going to live for you, and you'll do that to your best, the best of your ability. God will honor that. And God, like he did in Mary and Joseph's life, he will bless you and do amazing things through your life. But God wants to bring conviction to the surface. He wants to surface that in your life. I'm really excited to see family here. I love my brothers. I got two younger brothers that I'm close to, and I love those guys and their families. But I was so blessed when I got married, because not only do I now have two brothers, but I have two brother-in-laws that I also really love. And so I get to see all these guys here this Christmas week. And one of my brother-in-laws, particularly, his name is Brent. I've known him for about 17 years now. And so we've really grown up together and been good friends since he was, I think, middle school. And we've done a lot together. We've surfed in lots of different states together. We've played sports together. We've been pastors together at the same church more than once. We've just done a lot of different life experiences together. He came down for our launch day. He's been down here a couple times to visit. He's currently a professor at a Christian university up north. And he came down for our launch day. And we went down for the first time to Clearwater Beach. I hadn't tried it yet, been wanting to try it. We did the indoor surfing wave down at Clearwater Beach together. We went and we planted my first palm trees in my yard together. And like I said, we play basketball together. So one of the things I'm excited about Christmas is we, 6 months ago when we last saw each other, we made this commitment, or when we saw each other this last summer, we said, hey, let's both practice and let's play this one-on-one game at Christmas time when we see each other. This is a gym we're going to go to, and we're going to see who's gonna win this game. And we've had some real ultimate and intense like battles over the years of basketball. So like we're gonna play. I've been practicing. I've been playing every week. I don't know if he has been, so I'm kind of excited. I'm hoping he hasn't. But we're gonna have this big battle. So I'm really looking forward to that. But one of the things I'm not looking forward to when I see him is the whole present exchange thing. So I got him a gift. He usually gets me a gift. But every year, there's this picture he has that always surfaces. So like, I don't know, 10, 15 years ago, we were wrestling around, and like he had pinned me to the ground. He's a little bigger than me, and somehow he pinned me to the ground, and he had sat with his backside right on my face. And it's one of these embarrassing pictures where you just don't like the facial expression. Like I had this weird facial expression. I'm being squished. You know, he's sitting on me literally. It looks like I'm totally being destroyed. So it's kind of one of those pictures. If you're him, you're like, yeah, it just shows what's up, you know. And so he brings that picture every year at Christmas. And he tapes it onto one of the presents or something. And you know, the presents get laid out the night before around their parents' tree. And I'll kind of look around to see if I can snag it, steal it, hide it, you know. But it always comes up somewhere on Christmas Day. And I've tried to, like, get on his computer and delete it. He's like, dude, I have this backed up on multiple hard drives. You will never be without this picture. This is going to be with you the rest of your life. I'm like, thanks, man. That's awesome. It always surfaces, you know. It's like one of those things that just kind of comes up. It finds its way into the Christmas morning in some way. And for you and I, if we can become those kind of people that could surface within us, if we could bring up this godly conviction about what really matters in following Jesus, if we could do that, you know what God will do? He will find a way to bring blessing into your life. He will find a way to honor that. He honors those who honor him. If you will commit to him, if you will be convicted about, like Mary was, God, your will be done. You know what God will do? He will find a way. Some of us are worried that, well, if I honor God and I start living for him, and I make sacrifices for God, I give of my time, and I commit my life to him, and I do all these things, whatever it is that God wants of me, then if I do that for God, what if he doesn't notice? What if God forgets about me? What if I'm kind of over in the corner and I'm missing out on everyone else's partying and they're out on Friday night and doing all these things? And I know that's probably wrong. And everyone's kind of, you know, my business partners are cheating and they're making a little bit more than me and they're getting promoted and I'm trying to do the right thing. What if I'm over here and I'm honoring God, but he doesn't notice? And then I kind of get the raw end of the deal because then I miss out, right? And have you ever kind of thought that? And here's the thing. God will find a way to surface blessings in your life. He will find you. God God does not overlook those who do not overlook his promises. See, God honors those who honor him. And you can trust that if you place your life in God's hands, if you fully follow him in the year ahead, if you say, God, all right, I'm tired of casually following you. I'm tired of just being a curious Christian. I'm going to live and be a committed Christian. I'm going to follow you with everything that I have in this new year. I want to be like Mary and Joseph. I want to be set apart, and I want you, God, to use me. You know what? God notices that. It's kind of like the radar grid of heaven, and it just lights up, and God sees that. He notices that. Now, he may let you live for a time in obscurity, and you may feel unnoticed by God, and you may not see some huge change, but God, make no mistake about it, he notices the faithful, and he blesses those who honor him. And Mary and Joseph lived in obscurity. Their lives were not anything that you and I would talk about, but people have not ceased talking about their lives for these last two millennia, for thousands of years. And people will always talk about Mary and Joseph because they were the kind of people that honored God. They lived for him. And you're saying, well, no one's noticing. I'm just working away and I'm raising these children and it's hard work and nobody knows. And there's laundry and there's dishes and there's behavior challenges and there's schoolwork to be done and all this stuff. And listen, God sees that. And you just be diligent and you roll up your sleeves and you do what honors him. And you know what? It might not be for 5 years or 10 years or 15 years, but there'll be that moment when you can kind of sit back and you see those children and they're grown. They have families of their own and they're living for God. And you're like, man, all that work was worth it. See, you will be rewarded for your faithfulness. And there's some that are saying, well, man, there's such an easier road. And you're right, there is a broad road that's a lot easier than that's the one everyone else takes, but I'm taking the narrow road. But the narrow road that you're on, the difficult road of honoring and living for God and living for your convictions, that's the road that leads to life. And Mary and Joseph found it, and God found them, and he will find you when you find his path. He knows where you are, and he's going to honor you for honoring him. So will you live a life of conviction? Conviction, how do we get this kind of conviction in our life? Mary and Joseph seem to have it. How do we get it? And there's a very simple explanation, but it's very difficult to live out. And it's in your notes. Conviction grows from spending time with Jesus. Spending time with Jesus is where we find conviction. In Acts chapter 4, Peter and John, these two guys that had followed Jesus, lived for Jesus, they were followers of him, followers of the way. They were persecuted for their faith. They were in one of these difficult moments, and some people that had persecuted them noticed something different about them. And it says in Acts 4:13, when they saw the courage of Peter and John, and they realized that they were unschooled and ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men, Peter and John, that they had been with Jesus. So their courage came from somewhere. Their courage came from time with Jesus. How do you get courage and conviction in your life? You spend time with Jesus. Now, this year, for that to happen in 2017, you're going to have to find a time and you're going to have to find a place and you're going to have a plan. And, you know, my plan has shifted over the years. You know, certain seasons of my life, it was the last thing I did before I went to bed every night. Currently, it's the first thing I try to do every morning when I wake up. And sometimes it gets bumped later in the day, but it's usually the very first thing I do in the day. I'll spend time reading God's word, and my plan's pretty simple. I'll try to read a chapter from the Bible and think about how it applies to my life and learn, and I journal, I reflect on some things, I do some other reading, and I go on a walk with Jesus. I'll start my morning, and usually the kids are asleep, and so I'll just go out, and it's quiet, and I'll just pray and spend time talking to Jesus. And I try to talk to him throughout the day, but I make sure I meet with him every day. And it's a simple plan, but I just spend time with him. And that's shaping me. That's changing me. That's helping me be a better husband to my wife, Jennifer. That's helping me be a better dad to Jalen, Kylan, Kira, and Macy. That's helping me be a better pastor. That's helping me be a better friend. And I'm not perfect. I'm far from it. But man, God's changing me through time with him. And I'm becoming more convicted about following Jesus. I'm realizing more and more as the years go by, there's nothing that's more important in my life than following Jesus. And there's nothing more rewarding than following Jesus. I feel that the reward is internal. I feel fulfilled inside. I feel like I have a purpose and a vision for life. I have hope for the future. And I really believe the best is yet to come regardless of what this life brings. My hope is in Jesus, and it's an eternal hope. And I have the companionship of my Father that walks with me through the good days and the bad days. And I truly have this deep sense of peace in my life. I'm not like internally stressed out, and I have stressful days, but inside I actually have this calm feeling inside that I know whose I am, and I know where I'm going, and I know where I'm from, and I just just have this sense of groundedness in God. And it's just, it's shaped my life, this time with Jesus. That's how you develop conviction. You spend time with him. I'm going to go back to the Christmas story one last time in Luke chapter 2, verse 8. So Jesus is born, and I always loved, my dad would gather our family around and read from Luke chapter 2, and this part of the story, I love it so much. And there was these guys that got kind of looped into the Christmas story that really you would think, how did they get to be a part of this amazing, miraculous story? It makes sense that Mary and Joseph got selected, but these guys, the shepherds, how did they get to be part of the story? Verse 8, there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. So they're watching livestock, doing nothing super important, just kind of hanging out. There wasn't really anything majestic or marvelous about what they were doing. They were out in the field. And in verse 9, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. It must have been spectacular. Verse 10, but the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off. They found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning him, what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. So these shepherds got to meet Jesus. And when they met him, it changed them, because they went and they told everybody that they knew about this baby Jesus. And everybody who heard the story were amazed. And you know, this final lesson in your notes is this, that conviction drives us to share the Christmas message. You know, when we come to experience Jesus, we can't help but share that message, the love of Christ. We can't help but get involved in other people's lives when we see a need. I love this last year. One of the things I'm so encouraged by was that those many life groups that were spread all throughout the area that were part of church experience, that they went out and they were serving in the community. And we were rolling up our sleeves, helping people and serving people and making a difference in people's lives and serving the poor and unleashing compassion. I mean, that's what we should do, is we should be the church and be light in the community. And you know, when we see someone who's struggling, as we put an arm around, we pray for, we encourage, we invite, and we say, "Hey, come hear about Jesus." You know, we invest in people because we think that's where the greatest return of time or resources, anything that you can invest in, there's nothing that gets a better return in this life than investing in people for God's kingdom. And so we invest in people. You know, we give of ourselves, we surrender ourselves. And you know, when you are convicted, when God's shaped you and he's changed you, you can't help but share the message of Jesus with the world. In fact, in Acts 4:20, the last verse I want to read during this Christmas service about Peter and John, they were so convicted in following Jesus. They had been so impacted, even though they were facing persecution, potentially the loss of their own lives, they went and they courageously shared the message of Jesus anyway. And they said, "As for us, we cannot help but speak about what we have seen and heard." We can't help but speak about what we've seen and heard. We've so been impacted by the message of Jesus. It's so changed us that we have to share it with the world. So here's the question. How does our world actually change? How does light come into the darkness? How do people change? How does our community change? How do all the problems and all the things that are wrong with our world actually change? It changes through not a program or an organization or anything. It changes through a person, the person of Jesus Christ, the name that changes our stories. The name of Jesus, born of a Virgin Mary in a very humble beginning, raised and lived a sinless life like no one else has ever lived, died on a cross for our sins, rose from the dead, and is awaiting to return and is crowned King above all kings. This name of Jesus Christ, the King above all kings, is a personal king, an accessible king, a king that's a friend and wants to be a friend to you and be close to you this Christmas season, if you'll let him, if you'll open your heart and life to him. And if you will, he will be with you and walk with you through whatever 2017 faces. Whatever comes your way, God will walk with you through it. So will you put your life in his hands? Will you trust him this year more than you have in the past? Will you shape your character so that the favor of God come more into your life? My hope is that you and I, as we look ahead into this new year, and I'm so excited about what this new year holds. I'm excited for us together as a group, what 2017 holds, our two-year anniversary coming in a few weeks. I'm excited about all the things that God has around the corner. Many of them we probably don't even know, but I believe that God's at work in us, and he's going to work through us to bring light into the darkness, and he's going to use us to see things that we one day will look back and say, do you remember that time when we were huddled in a public high school? You remember we were starting that church and God was changing lives and people were being baptized and lives were being transformed. Man, look what God's done. Look what he's done in my family. Look what he's done in my neighborhood. That's what God wants to do. And you can't help but be passionate about that, about the message of Jesus when he's changed you. So will you get close to Jesus and let him change you? This Christmas season, break away. Spend some time. Spend a moment with Jesus. And develop the character that he wants to develop in you.
Thanks for joining Church Experience Online. Please don't forget to check out our website to get more connected, learn more, get your questions answered, or support this movement financially. You're now going to hear a Church Experience Worship original song. We hope this gives you time to worship and reflect on what you just learned.
Jesus, we trust in you.